live in God's world, and do we ever know that after these few minutes? Thank you, everybody. Thank you for being part of our setup as we figure out these new technologies and so on. We're missing you. You can hear the echo in this room. Your place is here. And for the present, your place is exactly where you are. Your church loves you, and we miss you, and we look forward to being together again. But for now, we're here at Thanksgiving, and where two or three are gathered, Jesus says, I am there. Susan Farrell is here. Tyson Kerr is here. I'm Catherine Faith McLean, the senior minister of this wonderful congregation.
It stopped recording.
It worked. Happy Thanksgiving. Thanks for being here. It's a great opportunity for us to welcome you to St. Paul's, to the church, to the building. The church is the people wherever we are, and to welcome you into the building. This morning it is Thanksgiving, and we remember that we are not alone. We live in God's world. And so it is that the three of us who are here in the sanctuary, along with others, all together make up our worshiping community this morning. We are not alone. We live in God's world. Susan Farrell is here. Tyson Kerr is here. Prudence Nabudi will be reading part of the lesson from Deuteronomy. Prudence, just 2 weeks ago, became a permanent resident of Canada. We are so excited for her. God bless Prudence, and God bless all of you who supported her in that endeavor. My name is Catherine Faith McLean. I'm the senior minister here in the St. Paul's community. And you know, where two or three are gathered, Jesus said, I am there.
Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there, I am there. Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there, I am there. Where two or three are gathered in my name,
once there was someone who did such amazing things and said such amazing things that people often asked him, who are you? Sometimes he said, I am the light. The light of God is among us. Neighbors and friends, in this strange and complicated time and in this strange and complicated way, welcome home, because our home is in God. Gather Us In comes to us from the Iona community with a few edits by my friend Neil Glover. There is a repetition at the end of each verse, the words gather us in. And if there is someone with you who doesn't read, a young child perhaps, that is an opportunity in the repetition to be part of the prayer. Gather us in. Gather us in. The lost and the lonely, the broken and breaking, the tired and the aching, who long for the nourishment found at your feast, gather us in. Gather us in. The done and the doubting, the wishing and wondering, the puzzled and pondering, who long for the company found at your feast, gather us in. Gather us in. The proud and pretentious, the sure and superior, the never inferior, who long for the leveling found at your feast, gather us in. Gather us in. The bright and the bustling, the stirrers, the shakers, the kind laughter makers, who long for the deeper joys found at your feast, gather us in. Gather us in. From corner or limelight, from mansion or campsite, from fears and obsession, from tears and depression, from untold excesses, from treasured successes, to meet, to eat, to be given a seat, to become like the least, to be found at the feast, gather us in, gather us in.
Sun and moon and stars of light.
is Nab de Prudence, and it's been a while. I miss you all, guys. I hope everybody's doing well. Those who are not, we lift you in prayers. Today's reading is from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verse 7 to 10. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey. A land where bread will not be scarce and you lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord. Thank you.
That you do not forget the Lord your God by failing to keep his commandments, his ordinances, and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. When you have eaten your fill and have built fine houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks have multiplied, and your silver and gold is multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrible, wilderness. An arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow for you from Flint Rock and fed you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and to test you, and in the end to do you good. Do not say to yourself, my power and the might of my own hand have gotten me this wealth. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, so that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your ancestors, as he's doing today. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of God. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You've seen lots of things for which we're grateful in the videos. Among them is a picture of a barley field. The barley field is at the University Farm of the University of Alberta, and it is just at the very edge of what used to be the Papachase Reserve. That field of barley moving in the sunlight, the various browns and golds, shadows giving a sense of where the fruit of it is, where the stalk of it is, the image of the breeze blowing across the grain, has a quiet beauty that gave me pause when I was on the other side of the camera. And part of what gave me pause was the understanding of who has been on this land. The Papachase, in that particular spot, that this is their historic land. The Cree, the Blackfoot, the Nakota Sioux, the Dene, all the others who have brought vibrant history and bring vibrant community together with our Métis neighbors and me and you. We live on this land together. And the beauty of the barley reminded me of the acknowledgement that we share this land over time and across the borders that are streets and roads, fences and gates, rivers and streams. I want to take a moment and thank you for the treasure that you are, for your time and your talents, for whatever you've been about in this last year since we gave thanks together, this last year since you had an opportunity at Canadian Thanksgiving to pause and give thanks in this particular way. There are treasures of God in you. Some of these are things that you're learning and polishing and getting better at. Some of them are innate characteristics of love and forgiveness and working together for peace and for better and deeper relationships. Some of the things that you bring are the gifts of your mind, the gifts of the labor of your hand, the gifts of your profession, the gifts of your hard work. The hymn for the fruit of all creation acknowledges that when labor is acknowledged, when labor is honored, God's will is done. And so we honor the work of one another. In this particular season, we're of course excited about the Nobel Prize winners who are being announced, the women and men who are being awarded prizes for the brilliance of their poetry and research and diligence. Michael Houghton is part of the University of Alberta and with two colleagues was given a Nobel Prize for the development of a hepatitis C virus. That is exciting news. That is exciting news. The World Food Program was awarded the Nobel Prize for Peace. And that draws us into an understanding that we are not simply people who acknowledge the good intent and the extraordinary work in God's world, and we do that, but we also acknowledge the need out of which there is room for this brilliance to make the significant difference that it does. And so with the World Food Program, we are reminded that we are all connected one to another. We are reminded of our own gifts of plenty at the table, our own hungers and cravings, our own connections with neighbors and friends and strangers around the world, as together we share the food that we are able to produce across the globe. And so in this we remember the ways that we are able to reach out. The Mission and Service Fund, which works in our communities and around the globe, where there are neighbors and friends doing the work that we're not present to do. We acknowledge the offerings of our local congregation, the hard work that's been happening here at St. Paul's always, but in these particular last few months, the hard work that congregational members have made to reach out and be connected, the hard work of the staff and ministers who continue to bring wonder and beauty and care and connection, the hard work of the board and the committees to make sure that the heart of who we are, the church, is still flourishing and vibrant in the community. We remember all of that, and we remember it in our gifts to mission and service, our increased givings perhaps to St. Paul's, in a time when we're not present to be together and encourage one another with our particular stories of giving. And so acknowledging how we're all connected, we also see that Thanksgiving can be a time of change and renewal. We often think of the spring as a time for change and renewal. New growth, tulips, crocuses, planting beets and carrots so that they're ready for later, planting squash and pumpkins so that in the fall they can be harvested. But Thanksgiving is also a time for change and renewal, because it's a time for reflection about the wonder that we share in Christian grace, about our personal freedoms, about, well, for instance, what it means to move from a sense of one day at a time back into a sense of the habits of a lifetime. One of the problems with this whole pandemic is that many of us do find ourselves living one day at a time. And for coping, that's critical. But we've been in it a little over 6 months now. And one day at a time isn't really cutting it. Our dreams are bigger. Our desires are bigger. Our abilities are bigger. And so this Thanksgiving week, really, this season that goes on, is an opportunity for us to think beyond the day at a time, to think of the impact that we are making from the gratitudes that we have. You see, this has to do with making gratitude and thanksgiving a practice and a habit, rather than a once in a while occurrence. And you see, when Thanksgiving is part of our everyday lives, it's a practice that helps save us from despair. Because although even through the despair that COVID brings, we lift up our gratitudes for barley fields, for neighbors, for grapes, for singing, for children, for educators, for research, for science. And in lifting up those thanksgivings, our despair diminishes. Thanksgiving as a practice also gives us energy to exercise forgiveness. In a time when one day at a time we feel constrained and nervous and tense about, for instance, political movements, a regular practice of gratitude brings us the energy to offer forgiveness where we need to. So it's not all just about me and protecting me, but rather about acknowledging that it is us and that we need to be able to forgive one another in order to have deep and true relationship. And Thanksgiving as a practice also brings us into being living Christians who live in grace, who live in grace, in an acknowledgement that things are not perfect, but God loves us nonetheless. So in this Christian practice of Thanksgiving, it is the stories of faith, the community of faith, the real presence of the Christ in our scripture, in our hymnody, in our relationships, the real presence of the Christ that turns us away from being just about me to being about others. And I give God deep thanks for the times when I see you doing that, when I see us encouraging one another to do in doing that. And I want to show you something in just a minute. Pumpkin gratitude pumpkin practice with Denise and Rondi. And when you're doing that, you're taking a black Sharpie and every day writing something for which you are grateful, making a gratitude practice, a practice of Thanksgiving. Beyond the one day, a practice of Thanksgiving, of day by day thinking of things for which you're grateful. So I thought maybe I would do the same thing, and I brought this pumpkin, and I was hoping that I could put things inside it, but instead I've hidden them behind it. So here we go. What are some things that I am thankful for? Well, you know, squash. This is a kabocha squash. Oh, I am so thankful for squash and for the people who plant it and who bring it to the market so that I can purchase it, I am grateful for that. I am grateful. I'm grateful for the ancestors. This grandmother and grandfather pair were brought from Japan by my mother when she was there after World War II. And we've always talked about them in my family as the ancestors. My mother went to Japan after World War II, and it was an opportunity to make relationships and figure out how to live together with people who had been the enemy. And so I bring you the ancestors. I'm grateful for my ancestors. You are grateful for your ancestors. And then there are the ancestors in faith, and that's why there's a Bible. Because the ancestors in faith bring us the ancient stories and the strength of Jesus the Christ and the promise that the Spirit is with us no matter what, and the creating and providing God who is with us every day, always, always. And when I think of ancestors in faith, then I think of you as well. I think of the community these days, and so I have a directory, and I have your beautiful faces, your smiling faces, faces of many of you who are part of St. Paul's. And you know, in here as well are many who are beloved and who have passed into the fullness of life, and I give thanks for them as well. Something else that I've got here. Yep, I am thankful for this. I really am. I am thankful for the masks. I have one here that is dove gray and it fits over the back of the head. It's really comfortable. And I have one here that's full of rainbows. And it's full of rainbows because we are an affirming congregation that acknowledges that God loves people of every sexual orientation and identity, and that we get to celebrate who we are, not simply tolerate or live next door to, but celebrate one another in the fullness of our being. Are welcome and honored, not just tolerated, but welcomed and honored and loved and celebrated. And I have one more thing that I want to offer to you. And that's the teapot. Because you may be aware that we started this service on live stream and it just kind of didn't take. The preparations were really, really good. It worked well before, but these things sometimes don't. So you know what we did? We paused and we had a cup of tea, and I am grateful to Tyson and to Susan, who have such patience and imagination, that we're making this thing work one way or the other. And we're doing it because worshiping God is essential. Finding ways of connecting with you through worship is essential. And so there's the pot of tea. And soon you'll be stopping and having a pot of tea too. And you know, you've figured this out, haven't you, already? How do I happen to have a big giant pumpkin? Well, you know what the answer is. Because we're looking forward to this too, aren't we? We have all these gratitudes in our minds and in our hearts. In our minds and in our hearts, we have all these gratitudes. And so with the ancestors in our Christian faith, we sing the prayer that Jesus taught, the prayer that over the generations has been said in languages and in music, has been said quietly and muttered in times of anxiety and offered in times of exaltation, the prayer that Jesus taught.
Thank you.
flowing with milk and honey. That is the perpetual promise from our God. And at Thanksgiving, we bring our gratitude for the milk and the honey, the nutrition, the nurturing, and the sweetness of our lives. We also bring thanks for the opportunities for our giving and for the promise that leads us onward, not simply in this day, but onward into the future, into God's fullness of life and abundance of life for all. So, live in gratitude for who you are. Know that we in the church give thanks for who you are. And know that God is with you. God who creates and provides. God the Son who knows from the inside out what it is to be human. And God the Holy Spirit who moves among us and within us in these wild days and beyond. Amen.